Good day and welcome back to another episode of Andy Analysis. In my video about the Gnossienne number 1 and the little spin-off that I made, I dived into Satie's use of modes in his melodic writing. Even though the idea was really not new at all, also already 130 years ago when Satie wrote the Gnossienne, modes gave a nice fresh sound and a much needed break from the at that time very dominant 5-1 formula. Now, using modes to write exotic melodies is one thing, but in the second Gnossienne, Satie took things one step further and also took a modal approach on the harmony. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Enough for the talking, let's dive into the music. Hello, viewers. Welcome to Andy Analysis. If you're familiar with the first Gnossienne, you notice that quite a few of the main principles stayed the same also on the second one. It uses the same style of accompaniment and the same notation without bar lines. It starts in G minor, but is actually notated without a key signature, which already indicates that something is a bit unusual. The other thing that stands out is the triplet pulse, which results in a lighter and more swift feel than on the number one. The piece doesn't have a tempo marking, but it does have a directional indication, avec étonnement. While the number one worked with a very small amount of different chords and got most of its character from its melody, the second one has a more diverse harmony, as you could already hear in the opening. However, the second Gnossienne is still a lot about melodic development. The A part, which we just heard, ended on this F, and the B part picks up right there. And also after that, the melody keeps developing. Funnily enough, Satie used the same trick here as on the number one. He only wrote three parts and relied on repetition to give the piece its final shape. As you may have already realized, the structure is reminiscent of a mirror, which A makes the piece very coherent, since it essentially refers to itself, and B also shapes its arc of suspense. In this case, Satie didn't use dynamics but mainly the register of the melody and the character of the modes to underline the shape. So we established that the melody takes the leading function here. That means the harmony should follow the modal approach of the melody, or simply speaking, if the melody is built on modes, the harmony is as well. But what exactly does that mean? How do we express horizontal scales as vertical chords? The basic principle that needs to be understood for this is the following. Let's say we have a piece in C major. By stacking thirds on top of each note of the scale, only using those notes which are contained in it, we get the triad, or seventh chord for the jazz cats, that belongs to each degree. Those are called diatonic chords, and you can think of them kind of as your customized little toolbox for the key that you want to write in. The diatonic chords of major and minor are the backbone of Western music theory, but of course we can use the same procedure for any other mode as well. The actual chords, that is chord qualities, major, minor or diminished, always stay the same and just the order changes. So it seems to be a relatively small change, but it actually makes a big difference. As an example, let's take the first bars of this German children's song, first played in F major, and then in F Mixolydian. Don't you also feel that the second version sounded sort of slightly impressionistic? What happened is that because of the flat 7 in the Mixolydian mode, the 5th degree became minor instead of major, which led to the 5, which we are so used to as being the glue that keeps our harmonic structure tied to the main key, essentially becoming a totally separate sound. This is one example of how French composers went about creating their new tonal language around the turn of the 20th century, by getting rid of said glue. In the Gnossienne No. 2, Satie consciously brought out these modal sounds by using those little slash chords, like for example here, or here. And the section you just heard also shows that the piece does not use only one mode, but in fact multiple ones.
Hey hey, this is Meta Andy. So, not only did Satie use modal harmony instead of major-minor tonality, but he didn't even use one constant mode, which is to say, he kept changing the tonal center of the piece. Seeing this from my admittedly biased perspective of the music around the end of the 19th century, I'd conclude that this must indeed have been quite a modern approach at that time. And what's even more interesting to me, who has a strong jazz background, is that this concept of composing with multiple tonal centers already came up this early in music history, when it took another 60 years for musicians like John Coltrane to use it in jazz compositions as well. Of course, the Gnossienne doesn't use Coltrane changes, which are indeed more advanced, but at the very core, both approaches have the same main principle, which is not having one single home key, or mode for that matter.
Thank you, Meta Andy. The only thing that is missing now is a small overview. And since this is the second piece of a bigger cycle, I thought it would make sense to have a direct comparison to the first one. I already talked about the similarities between the two in the beginning of the video, so here are all the differences. Number 1 is in F minor and uses functional harmony with only 3 different chords, 1, 4 and 5, while number 2 is written without a key signature and is built around multiple tonal centers. In number 1, only the melodies are built on modes, while number 2 also uses modal harmony. Finally, in number 1, the melody has a dialogic character, while number 2 features more of a continuous melodic development. So that means both harmony and form heavily rely on repetition in number 1, while we have an overall more continuous flow in number 2. In that sense, number 2 is not only the second piece chronologically, but in fact sort of takes the ideas of number 1 one step further. I'm not sure if that was intended, but I thought it was a really nice connection. I hope you liked this analysis and could get something out of it. I will probably also do an analysis of the third Gnossienne, so stay tuned for that. If you're new to the channel and want to stay up to date, feel free to subscribe, it would mean a lot to me. If you made it until here, thank you so much for watching, I really appreciate it. Hope to see you all on the next. Bye!